You're listening to the audio production of God is Your Defender, Learning to Stand After Life Has Knocked You Down, by Rosie Rivera, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
For my brother Juanelo and my husband Abel, for all the times you wanted to defend me with your fists, but instead you got on your knees and prayed for God to defend me. Forward. The book you hold in your hands, or are reading on the screen of your choice, as a case may be, is a challenge. It's a challenge to embrace God's promise to Moses in Exodus 14:14. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. It's a challenge to embrace God's promise to you. And Rosie Rivera is no stranger to a challenge. Rosie is a survivor. She openly shares her experience of abuse as a child and the tragic loss of her sister, internationally acclaimed singer Jenny Rivera, in a plane crash in 2012. Despite the hurt she has faced, she refuses to be beaten down or silenced by the enemy. Why? Because she knows God is her defender. When Rosie asked me to write the foreword for this book, I was humbled. Rosie is one of the most influential and inspirational Latinas in the world. She co-hosts The Power of Us, a marriage podcast with her husband Abel. She mothers three precious children, and she has now authored 5 books. She is a wife, mother, author, and influencer. She uses what the enemy intended for evil as an opportunity to glorify God and create good. She founded Sister Somalia, an organization that supports girls and women trapped in the cycle of abuse so they can experience God's healing as she has. Rosie is a woman of immense strength and faith because she takes God at His word. That is her daily challenge to herself, and that is her challenge to you and me. With conviction and compassion, humor and honesty, Rosie shares with us how she learned to allow God to fight for her, trusting that He will win every time. She invites us along with her on her journey towards wholeness, teaching us where the true battle lies, ways in which we try to act as our own defenders, and how we can finally place our struggles and sorrows in God's hands and leave them there. If you are tired of fighting, then God is Your Defender is for you. Reverend Samuel Rodriguez, lead pastor, New Season Church, president, NHCLC, author of From Survive to Thrive, Live a Holy, Healed, Healthy, Happy, Humble, Hungry, and Honoring Life. Executive producer, Breakthrough 2019. Introduction. It was a perfect Southern California evening. Clear skies. A few hours left of soft sunshine before sunset over the Pacific. No humidity. An outdoor temp set at just right. Not too hot, not too cold. A Goldilocks kind of end to the day. I'm not trying to brag, mind you. Look, I can't help it that California delivers up this kind of delightful evening. I was heading to the Little League field, ready to watch my godson play baseball at his favorite position of pitcher. The heavenly scent of corn dogs, yeasty giant pretzels, and buttery popcorn from the snack stand made a perfect evening even better. It's been my experience that junk food tastes better at a ballpark. Am I right? And I like to think the calories don't count. It had been a long, stressful day at work. I'd been cooped up inside, managing some difficult phone calls and grinding through what felt like 100 critical decisions. I love my work, but there are days it's all-consuming. I needed some fresh air and some time away from my phone, my computer, my desk, and the urgency of business. I was looking forward to putting all that aside and immersing myself in what felt like such a happy, innocent pastime, cheering on my godson, chatting with the other spectators, and enjoying the simple joys of little kids dressed in their baseball jerseys, celebrating the little wins. The first time my godson took the mound to pitch, I heard her, a mom with a kid on the opposing team. She was wearing all their swag, a parent jersey bedecked and bedazzled in rhinestones, a bright ball cap secured over her wild hair, and she was loud. She started bawling at the child who was up at bat, hollering instructions and opinions about how he should swing at the ball. Then she yelled unkind things about my godson's team. A lot of the other parents around me started shifting uncomfortably on the grooved metal benches of the bleacher stands, looking down the row at her. It's such an awkward thing when people raise their voices and change an environment from what has felt good-natured into something with a hint of hostility to it. We were a sea of uneasy spectators, breathing the fumes of an unfiltered mouth. I started thinking of her as Mama Yeller, and she was living up to her name. The kid up to bat got a base hit and made his way to first base. We supporters of my godson's team clapped politely. The opposing team supporters, understandably, made a more enthusiastic noise of support. And then Mama Yeller started again, her loud commentary echoing down the row. "That's right," she hollered. "You show 'em. They're weak." Ouch. Her content was starting to outpace her volume, which was saying something. The first inning wrapped up, and I resolved to ignore the loud distraction down the row, determined to not allow this woman to undermine the happiness of a giant pretzel smeared in mustard and one of my favorite kiddos playing his heart out. I wouldn't let some person with no filter and no apparent understanding of polite volume control ruin my evening. After all, I'd earned it, considering the day I had had at work. "Just relax, Rosie," I told myself. "It's a good night. Look at that gathering sunset. Breathe in the buttered popcorn perfume from the snack stand and breathe out the growing irritation with Mama Yeller. Breathe in, breathe out." It almost worked. Almost. In the fifth inning, with my godson back on the pitcher's mound, Mama Yeller's own son took his stance as the batter. My patience had worn thin, and the wheels came off. She started yelling insults about my godson. "He's got nothing you can't hit. He's no pitcher. You got this, son. Kill it. He's a loser." Mama Yeller had just turned the corner into making this personal, and this girl, your Rosie, switched in an instant to livid. Now, I aim to be a patient, empathetic person. I want to respond to people the way I believe Jesus would. I want to be the more mature person in any interaction. I want to take the high road. I've walked with God a long time. He's seen me through some pretty horrific stuff, certainly situations more traumatic and dramatic than some stranger yelling at my godson. But it was too much. Mama Yeller and her very targeted attack on a child I love as my own. I started to get to my feet, ready to give her a piece of my mind about her tacky jersey and her big mouth and crazy hair and her origins in general. I was ready to right this wrong and felt a sense of righteous indignation take hold. It was time to defend, time to set things right, time for vengeance. And then came that whisper, that truth I know and struggle to remember and believe sometimes. "God is your defender." "I know," I thought, "but this is just craziness. This woman is ruining the night. Someone should do something, and I can be the one." "God is your defender." I kept my backside planted on the bench of the bleacher while my feet itched to jump into the fray. "It's not fair," I raged internally. "Why do people act like this?" "God is your defender." Ultimately, I didn't get up, didn't march down the bleachers, didn't put her in her place, shut her up, shut her down. I'd like to tell you it's because I've got such a mature grip on the spiritual walk of mine. But to be honest, I was mainly concerned that if I said anything to her, I'd end up fighting her. Not just verbally, no ma'am. I was ready to come off that bench and physically take her down. Images of plowing her into the ground danced in my mind. The dust of the ball field rising as a cloud like the incense of vindication. Which would make sense poetically, since I was incensed. How like Jesus of me. 3 questions. Why do bad things happen? I've faced some really big hurts in my life. Seriously big. And I've faced smaller ones too. Like that little league spectator who was doing her best to ruin a perfectly lovely Southern California round of baseball. In all of it comes this question. Why do bad things happen? Big or small, bad things invade our sense of peace. They rob us of our sure footing, leaving us dizzy and reeling in their wake. When those hurts come, they can activate what psychologists say is one of our more basic instincts, the desire for revenge. We call it by many names: vindication, justice, revenge, retribution, retaliation, vengeance. If it's any comfort, some of the Hall of Famers of the Bible struggled with all of these desires. This drive to call out their enemies and fix things. There's a fancy $10 theology phrase for the kind of writing that expresses this desire for revenge. It's called an imprecatory psalm, and it means those places in Scripture where someone is calling down the destruction of their enemies, wishing all kinds of calamity and chaos on those who have hurt them. Theologians say that imprecatory psalms were prayers, as opposed to how we commonly think of the majority of the psalms as songs. Here is a list of the major imprecatory psalms, should you care to check them out. Psalm 5, 10, 17, 35, 58, 59, 69, 70, 79, 83, 109, 129, 137, and 140. Of these 14 imprecatory psalms, David wrote 9 of them, which means that more than 70% of these retribution psalms were written by the person Scripture calls a man after God's own heart, 1 Samuel 13:14. David's life, from the overlooked younger brother in a big family, to the kid sent out to watch over the family flocks, to the famed shepherd boy who took down the giant Goliath, to the young man who served as a musician to King Saul, to the man who endured all the conflict and hurt and commotion of his path to the throne of Israel, warranted plenty of opportunities to look for justice and vengeance. And David didn't mince words in his written cries to God. One of my favorite, and one of the most dramatic, imprecatory psalms is Psalm 35. May those who seek my life be disgraced and put to shame. May those who plot my ruin be turned back in dismay. May they be like chaff before the wind, with the angel of the Lord driving them away. May their path be dark and slippery, with the angel of the Lord pursuing them. Since they hid their net for me without cause, and without cause dug a pit for me, may ruin overtake them by surprise. May the net they hid entangle them. May they fall into the pit to their ruin. Then my soul will rejoice in the Lord and delight in his salvation. Verses 4 through 9. I mean, wow. Those are some fighting words. And it's in David's imprecatory psalms that I find I most often resonate with him, with the things he battled in his life, with his powerful emotions as he processed the challenges and enemies and deceit and plots that came against him. I often see David ask in his psalms why his enemies are so cruel. He asked why God hadn't responded yet. He asked when things would be set right, when a season of peace would prevail. He asked many of the same things I ask when I'm battered and bruised by the actions of others, when I'm hurting and wounded. It's not lost on me that David arrived at no conclusion other than that God is good and good will win. And he often referred to God as defender protector, shield, Jehovah El Elyon. We don't have the answer to why bad things happen. It's beyond you and it's beyond me. Sometimes a preacher might try to simplify this and tell you that if you just had enough faith, you wouldn't have been hurt. He might tell you there was something in your behavior or attitude that brought this bad thing about.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.